a bit surprised that Jerzy should have died at all, because he gave such an impression of perpetual energy, perpetual motion, perpetual ideas, a continual engagement with the world, and a determination to connect the arts to every aspect of it. You know, it's shocking to think of him as even of being a particular age, never mind a life that might end. So I'm going to put attempt the risky feat of sharing a screen so that we can have some of these images. Good. And if I just, okay, I'm just going to pan back through these. Sorry, we're getting these in the wrong order from the test we did earlier. I'm just going to go back and back. And back. Here we are. We start with, that's Jerzy in 2015, having lunch at the Russian restaurant near the theater, a frequent resort of his. And that's the view from the Mariaca Cathedral in Gdansk down to the Teatr Shakespearovsky itself. Jerzy was very much a member of the international conference that happens in Stratford every 2 years. I think that's where I first met him in the 90s. And the last time he was in Stratford was in 2019, when he was given the Pragnell Award, which is essentially an award for lifetime services to Shakespeare. So that's an award which is given to people like Peter Hall and John Barton and Judy Dench and Sis Berry and others. And Jerzy, who, you know, could have earned it several times over, he came, we had a little seminar about Shakespeare and cultural diplomacy. He was, you know, I got to hang a medal on him. We went to the theater, we hung around with the actors. It was a very, very happy weekend, as weekends with Jerzy tended to be. He being a very charismatic man, and Justina a very charismatic woman. Let's cut back to Jerzy, who's born in 1950. So, you know, he grows up in austere communist era Poland. He's from a very early age, he's fascinated by the Renaissance, by the cultural past, which seems to have been sort of cut off in many ways, or at very least narrowed down. And as you can see, in his youth, he became part of what was always a more or less underground rock movement. Jerzy loved rock music. That was the bit of the Renaissance, the bit of the arts that were really alive in the late 60s and early 70s. And here he is, you know, looking like one of the Beatles, or except slightly better looking, or you know, very least like one of the Monkees. Did you ever hear him sing, Ola?
No. No, Kowalski was the professor, and he, I think he wanted always to keep a certain amount of decorum.
Yeah, it was a role he could play among many others. It's something we talked about quite a bit, because I still play in a band, and he wanted us to come to Gdansk and play on the roof of the theatre. Something that from the point of view of Gdansk, I think it's probably not a bad thing that we didn't come, but you know, it's something I rather regret. So Jerzy was almost 40 when the Eastern Bloc collapsed. You know, the Berlin Wall didn't come down until Jerzy was 39, 40, but he absolutely hit the ground running. Things that hadn't been possible or imaginable, he had already been imagining. He'd got into academia. He was already an important scholar, but he realized that opening up to the West, opening up to a kind of cultural entrepreneurship, made certain things possible that hadn't been before. And yeah, I'm going to concentrate over the next couple of pictures on, I suppose, his monument, his physical monument at least, which is the Teatr Shakespearovsky, this extraordinary theatre in Gdansk, which began as an archaeological project, an antiquarian project in a way, but wound up being this astonishing modern theatre. Ola, what was his thinking about, what was his original impulse for thinking of Gdansk as a Shakespearean venue?
He was saying that actually his first sort of thought about reconstruction of the fencing school, which was that early modern playhouse, and now is Gdansk Shakespeare Theatre, was actually already in 1970s when he was doing his PhD research about English travelling actors. I think there was a little bit of local pride there because he was a Pomeranian through and through, born, bred, and he would never leave. So to find out about this amazing cultural cooperation between England and Gdansk, at the time was a Hanseatic city, free city, was quite, was already inspiring him. But he did, he was able to think about, even starting thinking about the project itself when Poland joined Europe. Although he set up his Gdansk foundation in 1991, from the beginning the thought was, and the decision was, we need to build a theater. But the decision was originally to build a replica Shakespeare's Globe. And then obviously it's been years and years before you get to the actual project. And what's happening during that period of time? It's festivals. Because to keep the idea of building that theatre alive and be able to gather the funds, he started the festival, which very quickly grew from sort of a smaller event. It was sort of 1 week called Shakespeare Days in August during St. Dominic's Fair, to a multi-national, multicultural event of 2 weeks. And I think he realized with time that the kind of productions, theater productions that he's getting will never suit a small wooden structure, a sort of a shed. He called playhouses sheds.
Yes.
So I thought that really his there was a long journey between his thinking of replica and then no, we can't have it. It's because we have a different kind of theatre here.
Absolutely, and he learned from the mistakes of the Globe replica in London, where the building has been rather constraining to the kind of shows traveling companies might want to bring to it, the kind of expectations that audiences bring to it. So he did both at once. I mean, as you see in the middle picture, he did indeed identify the foundations of the fencing school, which was the venue where traveling players came in the 17th century. I believe you've got a bit of it.
Yes, I do. It's my little treasure.
There you are.
I don't know if you can see.
Yeah, thank you. There it is. And I know he was very amused to discover that his archaeological dig had to take place in what was at the time the car park of the secret police headquarters.
Yes, equivalent of MI5.
Yeah. And there he is, having successfully dug up the Secret Service car park to uncover this 17th century theatre. And he then builds this astonishing modern theatre on top of it. And in the left-hand picture, there he is shaking hands with the architect, Renato Rizzi, who gets in. And he, you know, he had extraordinary charisma, as you were saying before we went on air, amazing diplomatic skills. And he managed to get Prince Charles to be one of the official patrons of the project. And there's His Royal Highness in Gdansk signing a document, committing himself to things. And indeed, he's remained a very genuine supporter of the project and sent a very moving message to Jerzy's funeral, I thought. So there he is at Highgrove on the left with Charles and Camilla, ensuring their support. And as part of the festival, which would keep the idea of bringing Gdansk to life as a Shakespearean venue again, he involves extraordinary figures from world theatre and from Polish theatre. That's Wider at the top. Didn't he direct a show in the streets?
I'm really not sure. Wider, yes. Hamlet, actually, Hamlet, all the most famous Polish actors who ever played Hamlet came to Gdansk and performed in Dwoga Street, which means long street, and it's really long, so there's a lot of space. So it was absolutely remarkable event. And I think this kind of public engagement and kind of reminding people there's a theatre being built here was very important to Jerzy. And even things like breaking out ceremony, starting the building of the project, construction site being sort of, not ready, was used for performances. Even when they just started working, there was this amazing event called the Ballet of Bulldozers. And that was absolutely Limon's idea. He loved performativity. Yeah. And he used this even construction site to sort of make sure that it reminds us that this is not another bank or some kind of office building being built here. No, it's a theatre.
Yeah, absolutely. And he managed to bring all sorts of the great and the good to that building site to look at it. I mean, there's Peter Brook in the bottom picture by the corrugated iron barrier. Even me, in these pictures on the next page in 2013, the year before it opened. I mean, I was, he stole my hat. I mean, I was still doubting whether this was going to be ready in time for the opening ceremony planned miraculously to happen punctually for the anniversary, the 250th anniversary of Shakespeare's birth. I'm going to attempt something further technical now, which is showing you a little clip, because I want people who haven't been there to see that building. And I've got an old clip from the BBC reporting just before the theatre opened, talking to Jerzy and looking at that incredible versatile structure. So I'm going to go here to this.
The works of Shakespeare were so popular in this part of Poland that this black brick building stands on the site of a 17th century Elizabethan playhouse. The original was built especially for the travelling English actors who would come every summer to perform in Gdańsk.
We are standing right now on the site of this theatre where English players performed, and during Shakespeare's own lifetime, his plays were performed here. So it's a historical site, and the whole idea of having Shakespeare in Gdańsk is not somebody's crazy idea or thought, but it has strong historical backing.
But unlike Shakespeare's actors, today's performers have one big advantage.
This is the only theatre in the whole world with an opening roof to give theatregoers that authentic Shakespearean experience, come rain or shine. It takes a whole 3 minutes for this roof to fully open.
The typology of the roof comes from history, for sure, because Elizabethan theatre was an open theatre.
But wouldn't it not have been easier to do a sliding roof?
If you work with a sliding roof, you lose the experience of the inner space, because now the inner space becomes double.
The theatre has some famous supporters. Britain's Prince Charles is an honorary patron, along with Poland's most celebrated director, Andrzej Wajda.
że repertuar tego teatru będzie się składał głównie.
The performance at this theatre will be mainly by groups who act in different languages. They will show their interpretation of the plays. This will be beautiful. Shakespeare has returned here.
Był tu Shakespeare, wrócił.
The curtains will be raised, as will the roof, for the theatre's grand opening at the end of the week. Kasia Madeira, BBC News, Gdańsk.
Yes, thank you, BBC. And I will go back to our pictures. Here we go. Yeah, I hope you could... Again, BBC are still going. Excuse me. Let me just shut up the BBC if I can. Oh, look. There you are, free bonus. You know, there are no borders to this alliance. Bollywood welcome. Right, here we go. Yeah, so it's 2014. And the slide has, of course, stuck the way they always do. We will continue via a different route, perhaps. And look at that, seamless, right? Here we are on that slide again. 2014, huge opening ceremony with speeches by the great and the good, mainly by Donald Tusk, since, of course, the theatre was largely built with European Union regional development money. You know, what an enlightened patron. There's Renato making his speech on the right, and Jerzy and Donald Tusk. Do you remember the bomb scare?
Yes, yeah. I do.
Yeah, there was a bomb scare during
but it was very interesting because it happened right after the speech that Prime Minister gave. And he mentioned in his speech Macbeth. And 15 minutes later, we were all rushed outside because of the bomb scare.
Yeah, yeah, as if it was the gunpowder plot. Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
It was fascinating. There's the video message from Prince Charles, which, as I recall, for some technical reason, ran at about double speed.
Yeah.
First time they tried to show it. There we all are in the theatre when it's in its indoor Italian cube Rossini march mode. You know, you've no idea what it's like in that theatre when the roof opens. It's astonishing. It's like being in Thunderbirds. You know, this huge sense of this enormous power of this thing lifting up, and suddenly you're under the heavens. It's a wonderful effect. And of course, the stalls can sink. A thrust stage can come out. It's very, very good idea to have a theatre that can do different configurations. You know, the RSC should have noticed this when they designed their current main house. Jerzy, of course, was, among other things, a specialist on court entertainments, Jacobean masks, spectacular allegorical events, bringing together all the arts, staging imaginary combats, imaginary invasions, reconciliations of different elemental forces. And he brought all of that scholarship and imagination to bear on the opening ceremony. Because after all the usual speechifying during the afternoon, we got this incredible display put on for the whole city of Gdansk as the theatre was stormed. And fencers, in homage to the fact that the original theatre had been a repurposed fencing school, combated. And with luck, we're about to see a little video montage of what that night was like. Here we go.
Thank you.
That was a night we will not see again, I fear. Remarkable. And after all the mask and the ballet and the sword fighting and the bits of Macbeth and all the rest of it, the culmination of the evening was that every citizen of Gdansk was invited to process through the building across the stage and be welcomed by the actors, which I thought was really remarkable. And you know, it was all about embedding this new building in the social fabric of the city, making sure everybody felt they had a stake in it and that they owned it. You know, really, it was just very, very moving to be there.
He believed that fencing school was used in the 17th century as the first public theatre. Yeah. And that's why he wanted to bring this theatre as well to the people. So despite of it being, state of the art, modern setup, meaning sort of, you know, open for any artistic proposition, you can do anything in that theatre. At the same time, it is absolutely still in the context of, in the spirit of Renaissance, this public theatre open to everyone and every day.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they have a cinema on the roof during the summer, don't they?
Yes.
Doors, yeah, which is...
Yes, it, again, I mean, there are no bear fights, but we do have cinema and concerts, rock concerts even.
Yeah, yeah. Well, long may it continue. It's an astonishing place. Here's some pictures from the festival the following year, 2015. There's you, look. And there's Emil Borogina, from whom we heard earlier in the day, a fellow member of the European Shakespeare Festivals network, which Jerzy helped to set up. There's I was there with Flute, who brought their Hamlet, which your husband photographed so beautifully. There's Mark Quartley, who played Hamlet, who's currently in Stratford rehearsing the role of Henry VI, book now. There's Kelly Hunter, who was here earlier, who directed and who played Hamlet. Everybody who's anybody was there. Ava Malecki, the director, you know, the whole lot. And there's some of, you can just see the reflection of the gables in the poster behind the glass of the Theatre of the Eyes, the Theatre of the Spectacles, the studio theatre that's the two shop windows, advertising what was on. A lot of Hamlet that year. And lots of stuff about Hamlet, as well as wonderful things. What's the ethos of the festival? How would you describe its criteria for getting shows in?
It's very complicated, actually, because there's not one stage that shows Shakespeare during the festival. There are many stages, but it's I think the festival is the reflection of how theatre is in Poland generally. So the main stage is for renowned directors, for well-known productions, for masters. Then there's a Shakespeare off scene, and the whole now actually mini festival nowadays, where productions of any kind can showcase Shakespearean productions. So it's absolutely open to any artistic proposition, but it's always tailored in a way that it suits the stage, it suits the context, time, place. It's really well thought out every year.
Mm. And the way it coincides with the Dominican Fair is a huge bonus. There are always lots of things happening in the streets, regardless of all the street performers and all the outdoor productions.
And also, I mean, every year, I mean, we, although there's this kind of multicultural dimension to the festival, there's also this kind of social impact that the festival is supposed to have. So it's supposed to sort of spill out from the theatre and the stages to people who live in Gdansk or tourists, anyone that's there. Yeah. And engage them. So to do that. For example, they set up a little tiny stage called Two Windows Theatre in Długa Street, which is the main sort of tourist street in Gdańsk where everyone is. And through the window, you can see also mini Shakespeare productions, or you can just come in and join in. It's a tiny stage for 40 people maximum. So it's definitely important in that sense, but also because community theatre, which is something that actually it's really well done in the UK, has been brought to the festival every year. Mm-hmm. And the community theatre helped also shape sort of even the social fabric of the city. So, for example, the disadvantaged part of the city called Dolne Miasto is invited regularly to perform in Shakespearean productions, which are sort of obviously amateur productions, but anyone can participate. The call that is coming out is like, who wants to play in this Shakespearean play? And surprisingly, everyone wants to. Mm-hmm. Someone, you know, who's 90 years old and, you know, a kid that is 6 years old. I can tell you as a sort of a side anecdote, I attended Parabola's Pericles production many years ago now, which was this community theatre project. And I decided to see it twice. And I met this boy of 7 years and he was there again the second time. And he was on the phone to his mom saying, "Mom, but I really had to come. It's so amazing." And this kind of impact of the theatre there, which sort of spilling out everywhere, I think, and Shakespeare, actually, is quite touching and amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It's you feel that when you go to the festival. It's seamless with the city in a way that some arts festivals in some cities just aren't. You know, that everybody is engaged in it. That the whole city has embraced it and is taking part in it. Yeah, we used to talk about trying to synchronize the dates of our conferences in Stratford with the festival in Gdansk, so that automatically everybody who came to the Stratford Festival from all Stratford conference from all over the world would just get into the habit of flying on to Gdansk. And we talked about getting, you know, a fleet of limousines to take everyone to Birmingham Airport, or just getting a big helicopter to land in the garden behind the Institute, which, you know, sadly is one of the many, many plans that Jerzy had, which he didn't get to realize, though heaven knows he realized a remarkable number. Oh, it's stuck again, the way they always do. I mean, because you're a Polish speaker and I'm not, there's one aspect of Jerzy's work that you know far better than I do, which is his fiction. You know, he wrote novels as well, astonishingly.
He did. And those are remarkable novels. They are kind of historical novels, but laced with politics, his knowledge of Shakespeare and everything else, and kind of Umberto Eco type literature. And Polish literary critics very often compare him to Umberto Eco. A very interesting book, he called it novel, but it's a sort of a multi-generic novel, was called The Whale. And in it, he fabricates original texts about whales, the huge mammal, not whales.
Yeah. They can make up fabrications of their own.
And yes, and he fabricates different accounts of whales from the Bible, medieval chronicles, and so on, and this kind of phantasmagoric novel, which is also about Polish politics, and in fact, Lech Wałęsa and those early sort of days of regaining Polish democracy. Mm.
Yeah. Do you think they'll be translated into English?
This is something that actually we are urged by now, we Shakespearean scholars, urged by the Polish theatre scholars, you have to absolutely have to translate Jerzy's novels, and also his series of books on theatre theory, actually. Mm-hmm. He wrote fantastic five books, mainly focusing on semiotics of theatre. And it's a huge body of work that is really worth translating.
Mm, yeah, well, I mean, here are a few of his books scattered in among these images. There's The Chemistry of the Theatre, which is the one theory book of his that has made it into English.
Yes.
Gentlemen of a Company, which is, you know, the sort of much revised version of his doctoral thesis on the English touring players. Dangerous Matter, his thing on politics. He had, not long before his death, put out his book about comedy and sort of a tradition of obscene comedy in Renaissance iconography and popular culture. He had another one coming out since then, as I remember. And I'm very glad that book on the right, This Treasure of Theatre, is his Festschrift, which a lot of people got together to publish as a 70th birthday present for him. And I'm very glad we didn't wait till his 75th, because, you know, I know he took pleasure in the fact that he was there. But he's an absolutely exemplary figure, it seems to me, because everything he did connected with everything else. And he wanted to provide cultural engagement and excitement and imagination and participation for absolutely everyone. And he could start with Gdansk because it was the city that he cared about and knew best, but it was going to go on expanding in concentric circles forever. And you know, there were no boundaries on his sympathy or his willingness to engage with people. And he drew a fantastic range of companies and languages to Gdansk to perform in his festival. And you know, he had such great music, a life that paid tribute to the Renaissance while sort of reenacting it. He was like a one-man show of all these opening up, without it being in any way exploitative or co-opting. He just sort of released people. And released other artists into this space where they could speak. I asked you earlier, before we opened up the session, whether you knew anybody who had ever disliked him. I don't think I did.
No, I don't know anyone who disliked him, but he... I mentioned that he was a true entrepreneur, and you have to be a true entrepreneur and diplomat if you want to do what he wanted to achieve.
Yeah.
And that is, you know, a 40 million theatre, which is the first theatre that has been that was built since the 1960s. There are no, because since Poland opened up and joined Europe, we built a lot of things, and we've been building a lot of things, but not theatres. So it's absolutely remarkable. And to be able to do this, you have to stomach everything. He was calling himself an institutional beggar because he had to beg for money. In fact, he was not begging. He was just really inspiring people and was able to get people together and build new networks that in the future would just bring fruit. It was just remarkable what he could achieve because he was the way he was.
Yeah, he was somebody who gave and hazarded all he had. You know, he was perpetually investing it all in the next thing and making it even bigger. And even wider and even more inclusive.
But at the same time, he always had time to cook. He was an amazing cook, absolutely remarkable. I will always remember that side of him. And he just was able to be kind of very personable, but also very relaxed and lighthearted all the time. All that work he's been doing, and he would always find time to meet you in a restaurant, to have a glass of wine. it's just you would never think that he's putting so much work or he's doing so much because he actually had time for everything.
Absolutely. He gave everyone the impression that he had all the time in the world for them, even while running a university department and running a theatre festival and raising money for an astonishing theatre and you know, dealing with the great and the good potential donors in several different countries. Absolutely astonishing. And you know, his persona is so always so relaxed, so generous, and so much about listening. You know, it's a very hard act to imitate. I certainly couldn't do it.
Definitely listening and bringing people together. The European Shakespeare Festival Network was his idea, of course. Yeah. And yes. He decided that other Shakespearean festivals, a bit smaller perhaps as well, because Gdańsk one is the biggest one, they have to get together and make sure that the productions that are shown at one festival can travel to another one, because he was considerate of a theatre artist as well. It's so expensive to tour a production. And so rather than seeing it once, you can see it twice or three times if you tour it around the festival network. But it's interesting that he really thought about Shakespeare as a bridge. Shakespeare was for him a bridge and for crossing all the possible borders. And whatever he was doing in his life, you know, all those novels and everything else, Shakespeare was for him the most important thing in the world.
It was the thing
informed everything he did.
It was the place where those things could meet and possibly even negotiate.
Yes.
Find utterance. And we mustn't forget that he raised two very nice, very accomplished children in the midst of all this as well, which is another thing which must have taken some of his time. I mean, you were telling me you didn't think he ever slept.
Yeah, I joked a lot that he achieved so much only because he's never sleeping. But yes, that's true. His wife was saying that he was not sleeping, but he was on the watch. But he was indeed working during the night. He was writing his novels during the night because that's when he had time to do also this.
Astonishing man. You know, we're very, very lucky to have known him, and the entire world of Shakespearean study and performance is very, very lucky that he put in the work that he did, because it's astonishing, and we will do what we can to follow it. Right, I'm going to switch off this PowerPoint and stop the share. If there are any questions or comments in the chat, Chris, of course, has suitably admiring things. And of course, you know, Chris knew Jerzy from the round table we had when he was last in Stratford. Mariana Sagasti in Argentina is inspired by his work, and so she should be. We're very, very grateful to Jerzy's other colleagues back in Gdansk who sent us images and there've been wakes for Jerzy of one kind and another, memorial events all over the Shakespeare speaking world. And I think they'll continue. Nobody who's read any of his work or been to that theater or been to that festival is gonna forget Jerzy in any hurry, and nor are we. But for the moment, until tomorrow's sessions of this conference, Chris points out, Jerzy was very keen on us extending our networks into Cyprus. Perhaps we'll put up a statue of him there, why not? Good. But for the moment, with many thanks to Alexandra for coming and sharing your insight into the career of this extraordinary man. Thanks Anna too, thank you for coming. The recording will be available to those who are in the wrong time zones to be awake with us at the moment, those who do sleep. And he was lovely. Great. Well, we're going to go for now. The conference resumes tomorrow. We look forward to seeing as many of you as may be able to join us then or catching up on the recordings. But meanwhile, with renewed thanks to Ola, his last toast for now to the memory of Jerzy Limon.